What a joy it is to come into your home on this day and realize that for almost a year now, we've had the privilege of being able to record these messages, share them with you as an encouragement and a blessing to you as you have journeyed in your faith during this COVID season. COVID has been vicious and challenging, impacting so many lives and putting us in a place where we've had to adjust dramatically as a church, but we've adjusted in obeying the Lord to keep ourselves faithful and committed to what He wants to do through each one of us. And so today it's interesting. We're in the middle of a series, as you well know, and what it means to live out the COVID life in the midst of Kairos moments. In other words, just in time, in the midst of all that's happening with COVID, we have an understanding that beyond the immediate, there are those moments that God gives us in the midst of life that are the right, critical, opportune. They are moments that are irreplaceable because they bring something to us that we could never get on our own, and that is God's specific time frame that He's planned for us. And so when you think about that, one of the things you begin to think about often is, as it relates to where life is and where we're going with life, is success. And it's interesting because in 1 Peter chapter 5, as Peter concludes his first letter, he brings them to an awareness of how submission and success work. And so today, we look at what it means to submit for success. So if you have your Bible, I want to ask if you would to open it to 1 Peter chapter 5. And as you're opening there, I want you to walk through a process of thought that guides my heart on a regular basis, because it's certain thoughts that allow me to submit and understand that He's at work, all right? And so first of all, He is Lord, all right? We know He's Lord of all. He will guide. He is in control. A fourth thought that you have is something that oftentimes I think is I will listen and I will obey. And so I think for a second, He's Lord and He'll guide. I know He's in control of everything. And so as a result, I'll listen and obey. And here's what happens. When you start thinking that way, His Lordship rules as you choose to obey and listen to what it is He's saying to you. So it's obvious that God can use that to shape our thought process and to guide us forward in experiencing what He intends. And so everyone wants to succeed, but it's interesting because Peter deals with success in a totally different light. And I want you, if you would, look at with me, because we've been looking at this word time, Kairos. Look, if you would, at verse 6 and 7 of 1 Peter chapter 5. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you at the proper time, casting all your anxiety on Him because He cares for you. That He may exalt you at the proper time. At that Kairos moment, He may use you in a more profound way. He may expand your impact. He may change the DNA of what you're doing in life and cause you to have a more effective and meaningful life. What you discover as you read this is, it's interesting because what He says is, what could get in the way of our success is anxiety. Because what anxiety does, it steals our perspective of how hope works. It steals our direction. It steals the meaning of life at times because we get anxious. And when we're anxious, we lose sight of the eternal. And so today, as you think about that, I want you to think about He's Lord. And I'm going to listen and obey what He says because He's going to guide me. He's going to speak to me. And that's exactly what He tries to get across in these verses. And so today, as we look at these, I want us to grasp that He's trying to convey something very substantive to each one of our lives. And perhaps as you're watching us today, maybe you find yourself feeling overwhelmed and wanting to succeed in something, but not understanding how to submit in order to experience that success that God intends for you. If that's the case, then today's message might really be an encouragement to you. So let's begin reading, if we could. If you look in 1 Peter chapter 5, notice what he says in verse 1. Therefore, I exhort the elders among you as your fellow elder and witness of the sufferings of Christ and partaker of the glory that is to be revealed, shepherd of the flock of God among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but voluntarily, according to the will of God, not for sordid gain, but with eagerness, nor yet as lording it over those allotted to your charge, but proving to be example to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appeared, you'll receive the unfading crown of glory. And then notice what he says, you younger men, likewise, be subject to your elders, and all of you clothe yourselves with humility towards one another, For God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in, at the proper time, casting your anxiety, all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Be of sober spirit, be on the alert. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. But resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same experiences of suffering are being accomplished by your brethren who are in the world. So, what you see here is he shapes their thoughts as he's finalizing his letter, and in his writing, he brings to light what humility does. Because what humility does is humility recognizes authority, and when you submit yourself to what it is God has for your life, you're submitting yourself to his authority. And when you make that submission, it absolutely opens you up to be able to succeed in a greater fashion, because then you know you're being directed by God to accomplish what he wants to do through you. So let's look at this text and let's see if we can't pull out some nuggets that would give us some kairos thoughts, some moment, those right critical opportune moments to think through what it is perhaps God's trying to say to us. First of all, I want to look at the foundation. And you'll notice in verse 5, he says that you clothe yourselves with humility. The foundation of us succeeding is understanding how humility works. And what it does for us is it helps us see God the way he intended for us to see him. We humble our hearts. We're grateful to God for what we see. We experience his presence in our life because we are humbly coming before him, submitting our hearts and lives to him. Because what happens is all of a sudden you get this really firm foundation that really guides your life. And I want you to note some verses that I think will be helpful to you. And I just wanted to look at a few of them because I'll point them out to you, then you can perhaps look at them later on, because I want to make sure we don't miss understanding that the Lord speaks to us all through his word on concepts related to this whole idea of humility, how it works. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 12. Listen to what it says. So, as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another, forgiving each other. Whoever has a complaint against one another, anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also should you. You see, Paul writing the Colossians said, you know what, this is so important. That you take the time to put, it's interesting because he says, he makes it this, put on a heart of humility. You see, when you clothe yourself with humility, you're wearing something that matters. You have something on it that takes you where you're supposed to go. And we've been in some cold weather here in Atlanta over the last number of weeks. And I find myself, when I get up, I'll put on one layer, two layers, and three layers. And today I have on three layers just to keep me warm. Keep my body warm. And here's what I want you to see that transpires when you look at this text in 1 Peter. He wants us to, Peter wanted us to put on layers of goodness and kindness and humility. He wanted us to see people the way God intended for us to see them. And so that's Colossians chapter 3. A couple other verses that I would point out to you. In Luke, in the 24th chapter, there's a great verse that I just want to point out to you. That has such significance when it comes to our understanding of the foundation. Remember, the foundation of everything that we look at by way of success is clothing ourselves in humility. And so in Proverbs chapter 24 and verse 49, if you look at that with me, you'll see, notice what he says. And behold, I'm sending you forth the promise of my Father upon you, but you, watch this, are to stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. All right, so here's what I want you to get to understand. That this idea of clothing means that we put on our hearts and lives the things that really allow us to experience him the way he intended. And here, Jesus' words, I'm gonna clothe you with power, all right? Peter's words here, you're gonna be clothed in humility. You look at what happened in Paul's words, in Colossians, it has the idea of being clothed with goodness and humility and several other things, and kindness and love. What do all those things do? They open us up to experience God the way he intended. Today, I want to ask you a question. When it comes to the clothes you're wearing in your heart, would people see goodness and kindness? Would they see love? Would they see you connected to God's purpose because you are foundationally clothed in humility? If that's the case, then you have found the right path to get on. A second thing I want you to see. So first of all, we form this foundation. And keeping in mind, by the way, He is Lord. I'm going to listen. I'm going to obey. He is Lord. I'm going to let Him guide me. He's in control. All right. Keep those five thoughts kind of bouncing around in your mind as we process on through this. Now, let's look on, because here's where He gets to the real heart of what He's trying to get across. Because what He wants to make sure is we understand something, that there is a formula for success. All right. And that formula, you'll see it in verses 6 through 9, okay? Look at it if you would. Therefore, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you and help you succeed at the proper time, casting your anxiety in Him because He cares for you. Be of sober spirit, be on the alert. Your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. But resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same experience of suffering has been accomplished by your brethren who are in the world. So let's think through this, because it kind of sequentially walks through a process that helps us learn how to succeed. First of all, we submit under His hand. You see, it's His Lordship, His hand over us, that allows us to experience who He is and what He wants to do in each one of our lives. And you have to be willing to sense His hand at work, to go this way, to go that way, to do this or do that, to share or to speak, to listen and to learn. It's all about His hand on our lives. So first of all, you submit under His hand. Secondly, you recognize, you reckon with anxiety effectively. He says, casting all your anxiety on Him, which tells you something. We are not supposed to bear the unbearable. Jesus bears that for us. He takes our anxiety, which is our allowing feelings to control beyond our faith. When we get anxious, it's a feeling-based thought process that causes us to, if we're not careful, move away from having a successful life to end up struggling to find direction that we need. And so be wise when it comes to, you know, you take these steps of success, all right? You see Him, you submit under His hand, and then you effectively deal your anxiety. The third step you take in order to succeed is you balance your life with disciplines, because you'll notice there, He says, be of sober spirit, be on the alert. The adversary is coming at you, but resist him firm in your faith. So these disciplines that God has for us are the discipline of prayer, the discipline of pursuit, the discipline of obedience, the discipline of gratitude, the discipline of generosity. All these things lead us to success in life. And so we have to be willing to balance our life with the disciplines that God puts before us so that we can become more effective. Because the more disciplined you are, the more direction you have, the more successful you'll become, all right? So the next step in that journey is watch for the adversary, because it says he walks around like a roaring lion, which tells you something. We have to keep in mind there are moments the adversary is going to come at us and try to steal our joy, try to capture us away from God's purpose, and we have to be wise enough not to allow anything to get in the way of what it is that God is trying to say to each one of us. Be wise, be diligent in pursuing Him, and as you do that, the adversary, he can't have ground you don't give him. And so do not surrender any territory to him, because you surrender territory to him, what happened? You become less successful and more overwhelmed. And you want to be blessed and underwhelmed by all the things around you, because the adversary will come at you. And it's, by the way, it's one of the single most affirming aspects of your faith journey is that the adversary is trying to displace you, trying to steal your direction. That means God has something bigger in store for your life. Now, the next step that you take in success is you trust beyond your sight. In other words, you don't look at things just in light of your what your eye can see. You trust the Lord beyond anything. And I'll tell you what happens. When you start trusting Him, you get stronger, you get more motivated. And then finally, you realize that His grace is there for you. Because if you'll notice in verse 10, after you've suffered a little while, the God of all grace who called you to His eternal glory in Christ with Himself perfect, confirm, strengthen, and establish you, which we'll come to in just a moment, all right? So let's get this in mind as you think about it. First of all, there's the foundation that is about clothing yourself in humility. Then there's the formula, which is about starting with an understanding of putting yourself under His hand and ending with letting His grace rest on you. And then finally, there's the opportunity for us to be able to focus our lives on what really matters, all right? So our focus in life, basically what Peter does is he says there are really four things you have to do in order to have the right focus. Look at them if you would, because you'll see it here. He says in verse 10, will Himself perfect, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. All right, so let's think about those four qualities that He has. First of all, to perfect is to complete. In other words, He who began a good work in you will complete it. All right, that's what Paul said in Philippians. That's what Peter says here. You're perfected by Him. Then he uses the word confirm. And that has something to do with setting fast, all right? Being established so that it can be accomplished the way God intended. And what he wants to make sure we understand is if we're firm in what we believe, then we'll be successful in what we try to achieve. And so we have to be very wise to commit ourselves to living out, being complete in Him, being confirmed by Him, being strengthened is the third area. And when he talks about being strengthened here, he's talking about stabilizing something. It'd be like something that was rocking, and all of a sudden you anchored it into something that made it really, really strong and stabilized, and nothing could move it. Listen, what Jesus does in us, He stabilizes us in the midst of our anxiety, our difficulty, our challenges, our heartaches, and He sets us in motion to encounter Him in a living and vibrant, dynamic way. That's why when you look at that verse, at the proper time, He's going to do something for each one of us. He's going to work in our lives and He's going to bless us. Then finally, you'll see that he talks about that the Lord will establish you. And what is that about? It's about having the right foundation. Because listen, if you have the right foundation, and we're going to see this in a few weeks when we get to Acts chapter 1, one of our Kairos messages, just in time, links into what happens when all of a sudden Jesus is about to ascend into heaven. And what Jesus knows is this: He has built a foundation that's rock solid because it's built on Him, and His disciples will accomplish the mission that's before them. So today, as you think about your own life, I want you to take just a moment and think about your foundation. All right, that's where we started at, that you would clothe yourself in humility. I want you to think about your success formula. How you succeed. Would it be that you begin with submission and you end with grace, like Peter illustrates here? And then you begin to think through your focus, what you're focused on in life. And I know this, if I'm focused on Him completing and setting fast and establishing me forever with the right kind of foundation, stabilizing me in the midst of adversity, what am I going to do? I'm going to experience God's best. And so today I want to ask you a question. Think about that. Are you ready for success? Because if you want to succeed, what happens? You apply God's word to your heart and life. And again, let me remind you of how He says this. It's so important. Verse 6, therefore, humble yourselves in the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you in the proper time. Which tells you something. Our greatest success comes in our humblest moment when we sense humility at work in us and we sense God speaking to our hearts. God bless every one of you if you've listened carefully today, because my prayer is that you are going to submit to what God's plan is so that you succeed in a supernatural way. That is what makes life worth living. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your amazing word that speaks to our life. Thank you for your faithfulness in guiding us. Thank you for your encouragement to our hearts. Lord, bless every person who watches this message. May it speak to their hearts. May they be encouraged and may they be strengthened. And may they realize that all these Kairos moments are the moments we should capture, not miss, because they're the moments that shape our lives forever. We love you, and we commit this to you, trusting you to guide us every step of the way. If we pray this in Christ's name, amen. Well, what a joy it is to be able to come and share God's word with you on this day. And obviously, we have a live stream that happens Sunday morning, 10 o'clock. We have opening our worship center back up for worship in person this Sunday as well. We'd love to have you. We'd love to see you be a part of what we're about. And we know this. God's at work in a great way at One Heart Church, and we'd love to have you to be part of that. If you're already a part of our family, we love you. We're praying for you. Stay safe, stay wise, stay submissive to God, and watch Him lead you to success. I love you, and look forward to seeing you soon. God bless now.